Right.
Pupillo
Tell you what,
area.
let's start again. Right. Because I always do. Okay, welcome to the Crate and Kobold, a 5th edition D&D podcast. Our players are Blaze Masterson.
Hey, I'm playing Keys, the Lord, half-elf, noble rogue, Count Basie. Goes by about six different nicknames. He knows where the party's at.
Bloody Teddy.
Hello, I play Hugues, the human paladin, rage criminals.
Kian.
I am keen to play Jamie. Get Jamie, get her done. The rogue, not rogue, ranger, savant, crazy person.
All of the above, and no one else. Currently, Quinn is away. She might turn up later. Who knows?
Oh no, but it's fine because it's
Yes.
still here.
Yeah,
Hello,
in
it's
spirit.
me.
It's
Quinn.
It's uncanny.
That was incredible. That was amazing. By the way, let me do my intro again. You ready? It's your boy Keys, aka Lord Citadel, the half-elf noble rogue, aka Count Basie, aka LeBlanc Hand, aka Duke Ellington, aka Ocho Nombres Nuevos, aka the notorious D&D. What's poppin'?
Yeah,
It's
so.
better. Do you have this like written down somewhere?
Okay, I'm hyped.
Yeah.
I'm hyped. Let's get it. Let's
Yeah.
go.
I think he's got
I'm
like
standing up now. I'm gonna D&D
I
standing
was
up.
taking notes, but yeah,
It's
that's how I
tattooed
get it.
backwards on his chest and he's standing
Yeah,
up.
it's lit.
Well, you're like Superman, but in a mirror. Wish you did it
Yeah.
wrong.
Yeah, just Superman, but much less iconic.
Yeah.
Superman, but you don't mind helping people. If the latest film is to be believed. So you've
Ah, yes, the
just.
backwards S on my planet means dyslexia.
Okay. You've just woken up. You've had a fight. Let's see.
We had a
Yeah,
fight.
you had the fight with the
Blaze kicked
zombies.
me out of the bed.
And.
I had to sleep outside.
Yeah, and Yigbeth had a weird dream. So, next day, the morning has broken, like the first morning, possibly, and you are still in the forest, and you're still on the trail of some ettins. What are you up to?
I
Yeah,
punch the
Johnny, what would you
ground
do?
and
Crack.
sense everything in 6 feet.
You solved my ground puzzle. So you're doing a tracking thing. Do you want to give me some sort of nature roll?
Yeah, I need to open my character sheet. Remember how to do this. Oh, it's on my phone, actually. Oh, I'm so good.
Love how you do your homework, Kian. Always just ready, just ready.
I come prepared, okay. Would you know that I play like four campaigns?
Actually, doesn't he have that thing where it's like he can tell without a roll if something is in
Yes, okay, 6 miles.
six
Is
miles
6 miles
I can
already?
just tell. I just spend a spell slot doing it.
You're not actually getting anything within 6 miles.
Okay, I'm gonna rest and get that back.
Okay.
Thank you.
Which is right now. Which
Yeah, just say just he wakes up first thing in the morning. Is it there? Oh, never mind. All right, I'm gonna go back to
just
bed for a
falls
second.
unconscious.
Well, you know what? Tell you what, 6 miles is quite a long way, given this terrain. Yeah, okay, you get a sense of Etten's further into the forest.
There.
That
I point.
direction.
Yes. You point in that exact direction, and that's where you go.
Perfection.
Let's a go.
So, the morning passes fairly uneventfully, but after a while you start to hear voices, and it's perhaps not the voices of Ettins. It sounds like a group of human beings.
I listen in carefully.
Yeah, well, as you get closer, you realize these are the voices of the men that you encountered the other day. at Indeman's office. And it sounds they're the
shitty workers that we kind of were like, oh yeah, they I'd fire them too.
Yes, exactly. So as you get closer to them, they're having a discussion about what to do with whatever they catch. One of them saying, oh, you know, sod Enderman, the rate she gives us, it's not worth our, you know, it's not worth the risk. And the other's like, well, if we don't keep her at least slightly happy.
Port servers are busted or something? Hello? Oh, there you are. Yeah, we got you.
Hello. What happened?
Nothing. We've been waiting on you.
The army busted into your house, baby.
No sure. D&D. Should be no asleep. D&D.
Okay, so my plan is this. When we get to the Etten, I know. I'm about to cap it. I'm not even recap it because I haven't even started. I'm about to cap it. I'm about to cap it for the first. So the deal is that I'm going to give Jami the ether, and I am going to be the bait for this Etten and just have him like run around in circles around Yigbeth, more or less, whose main job is going to be to keep the thing from beating up on Bree, right?
Wait
a second. What about the dudes?
I'm sorry. Like once we get to the Etten, we're not even there yet.
Can we
No, but I disconnected when we found the guys.
The decision was just to leave them alone. They're hopping on their own, and they're complaining about, or they're sort of discussing whether they should sell to Indeman or to bring it to. You've heard the name of the pub again, the Portly Goblin.
Okay. Two things. What's our plan on a macro scale after we get this guy?
Okay, Glenn, I'm glad you asked. He said, laying out an exotically large blueprint. He's he's pulled out of his back pocket.
You come to the table.
All right. Over a whiteboard with.
Yeah, exactly. I'm breaking out the visuals. I got a laser pointer that's magic. It's a wand. It's a wand pointer.
Step one.
PowerPoint presentation.
Exactly. Step one, cast illusion for my PowerPoint. And then the idea is that after Jami, you have ethered one of the Etten's heads, we will then have a two-headed beast that is docile. And as we are escorting it back, I took, last level, I took proficiency in religion specifically so that I could do this. I am going to speak to the unconscious head while Yigbeth speaks into the conscious head. I'm going to tell the unconscious head every rite, every like ignoble, unholy rite that I know of to Orcus, the god of trolls, orcs, ettins, ogres, and goblins. Meanwhile, while I'm doing this, like fucking vile, like religious knowledge, while I'm pouring this into his other head, you, my friend, are going to talk about everything you know about being a paladin, and we are going to make
teach him
this
to be
Etten into a god paladin king of the Ettens, and he is going to lead the uprising. Well, I'm going to use my disguise kit on his head and put makeup onto the side of one of them so it looks like it's been trepanned. Then we're going to return him. Then Quinn and I, this is the other reason I took a bard last level, was specifically so that I could do this specific thing. Quinn and I are going to give bardic inspiration to every trepanned Etten inside the thing. Then we're going to leave and let everything just do its own magic. That's the way of nature. It satisfies Johnny's like craving for the natural law of might makes right. And we've just like set the table equal. And then we can watch like the explosions from afar as we're walking away slowly, totally toward the camera.
And not looking back.
Exactly.
Okay.
What do you guys think?
Had to get that straight in my head.
Sure. Sounds better than anything I could come up with on the spot. Maybe not really. Guys, I don't know if you noticed. I'm pretty good, says Jamie, and definitely not Keen. So let's do that.
Okay.
The second thing was these guys aren't like walking or discussing us, are they?
No,
Walking towards
not
or
you
discussing
have
us?
heard yourselves. Well, you've heard yourselves mentioned, but only in passing. They're essentially sound like they're hunting around for the same thing, but you know, they're traveling in a similar direction.
Kind of shut the fuck up
Obviously,
sorry to
Ettins
go
are further into the forest, essentially. You might be able to. You would, with your weird senses, you would. Know where they are a little quicker than they would.
Yes, I'm going to conceal my hand. I'm going to put down my hand instead of pointing and walking in the direction of the Ettins now.
Okay. Do you want to give me
So
some
they
sort of
pass.
nature roll or other roll, basically to see how well you track them down?
Let me see if I have any skill about that.
You have a survival skill. It should be near the end of your list.
Yeah, sorry, I meant a feature.
Quite possibly. Given your wood
Are
elfiness.
Ettins beasts?
Beast, not quite, no. Let me just actually, I might need to look that up in the monster manual, but
If it is, then I got advantage on checking this.
okay, just amuse yourselves while I look this up.
Yeah, I need to check what my okay. Yeah.
So, Kian, what are you
Good.
you're agreeing with my plan? Is that correct? I missed the one statement you made. Like
Yes.
what? Yeah, we're down. All right, cool. Just making sure. We talked
Okay.
about this.
Right. So they're essentially giants, which they're not quite beasts, and they're not quite, they're not quite humanoid.
Okay. Yeah, let's go towards them.
Okay.
Oh
Let's
yeah, you want me
see.
to
What do you
do the roll?
roll?
I mean, again, it's a case where, like, if he names a creature in the forest, like he can actually like pinpoint location. It's not, there's no role. It's just like, yo, you're okay, it's right there.
Yeah. Essentially he's using his senses to, well, he's totally able to get the general idea of where they are. And from what you know of Ettins, that might be good enough because they're extremely loud creatures.
Simple, easy.
Yeah. So you walk on for maybe a couple of hours until you actually do start to hear them. From what they sound like they're saying is pretty much a litany of insults and just mad babblings. But sound doesn't travel all that well in the forest, but they're just so loud that, you can hear them quite a way off. And that essentially allows you to hone in on them pretty nicely.
Okay, I'll hand Jami the ether and the rag and instruct him on its use because I'm proficient with the poisoner's kit and I'm proficient with poisons or whatever. And then I'm gonna ask him to sneak up while this thing is arguing with itself.
I'm going whoosh, and I jump
And
to the tree.
while he's doing this, I'm going to click my slippers of speed together and be ready to run out in front of and cause a distraction in the case of in case this thing is able to actually see in case it perceives his sneak attempt. I'm gonna run out and become the bait so that he's able to do this.
Right.
You put slippers of speed in the chat twice because, two slippers of speed,
Yeah.
apparently.
They're the same on both sides. So you might see another area opened up there.
Yep.
Okay, so you can approach this basically from any side you want. Or if you want to, like, surround it. This is the area in which the Etin is.
Which is, this whole area is where it is.
Yeah.
Bush.
I guess Kobe will just kind of... Like, I mean, he could just be a bear. I mean, he doesn't need to hide.
He can be a bear, yeah. That's totally legal.
I'm going to hide in the tree. He's just going to be bearing around.
Mm-hmm. Bear necessities. Let's see.
He's actually going to climb this tree for honey.
Good to know. Let's see. Gonna shove Bree in there as well.
Just in the middle, in front of the big Eden.
Let's see.
The picture of Joey really fits here. Peeking out of a door in the trees.
Right. I think anyone can control her now. Just grab it. Can't. Okay. What the hell? Try it now. Okay. Cool. Lands from up in the trees.
Please don't make Bree just run out in front of them. Oh God, why?
It's pretty much a rule that. And please don't abuse this, but she can't die while she's not here.
That's just courtesy. That's just courtesy, people. Come on. Basic courtesy. Basic D&D courtesy.
It's fine. She's riding Cubby in a totally inconspicuous way.
Okay. So, you see this, Etin. It's in the clearing. It seems to be like... crudely making its dinner, essentially just stripping the skin off a deer and taking big chunks out of it. But yeah, it seems to be in its element and happy enough. It's sort of shouting at itself.
Can I?
One head takes a bite that the other side doesn't think is fair. It will sort of strike at itself with the other hand. It seems like one half of the body is controlled by one head and etc.
I wonder if it's better to just sneak up on it now or like make a distraction and make him come over to the tree and then do that.
I say just sneak up now, personally.
Sure. Then I'm gonna like a leaf.
You're gonna sneak over.
In the wind.
Okay, I'll need a little stealth roll. And the target number is I was going to say 15. yeah. You make it. So you can, it's so absorbed with what it's doing, you have no problem just sneaking up and getting into whatever position you want to be in.
Boy.
Okay, you notice a huge stink. This thing is foul, it's nasty. But it seems content enough.
Then I'm just going to maybe use the ether. Is this the easiest way to do it? To just kind of claw up him? And...
Okay, so the plan is to climb... What, are you going to hold a rag over his face?
That's what I was given.
Okay.
Sounds right to me. That's how ether's used.
Yeah. okay. Let's see. I need to think about what this is going to be. Essentially, this is going to be an unarmed attack.
No, sleight of hand or like athletics thing?
Would it be acrobatics?
Could be acrobatics. What are you going to do? Like, just literally run up his back?
Yeah.
Okay.
I do a little flip.
Climb up his, like, toga or whatever, like his, you know, shitty fur loincloth or whatever.
Okay, well, his
head. Put the rag on an arrow and shoot it in his face.
His hands are sort of deep in this deer. And not like a, but he sort of bent over and focused on that. Could... So.
His back hair, you can climb.
Yep.
Climb his back hair, dog.
Yeah, we're fine.
Yep, you have no problem doing that. However, as soon as you start to climb him, he does notice.
Damn. And
yeah, you're going to need to make an attack roll now to actually clamp the thing over his face.
Okay.
Twelve. Okay. For now, you manage to hold on as it stands up. You don't totally get a solid sort of clamp over his mouth with the rag, but he is inhaling this stuff.
This is some like Shadow of the Colossus moment.
Pretty much. He stands up. He is a huge, you know, he's the squares. So he's like four times the size of you. And he stands up, and you basically will have to hang on. And everyone can roll initiative now. Unless there's like a sneak attack thing that you want to do.
I win. When he stands, I think I'm actually going to want to rush up and then just throw myself at his leg and try and knock him down.
What?
Okay.
I mean, like, that way you're going to have an easier time, like, you know, like holding on to him, right? Don't you think?
Wu learn nothing from running into people?
I can help. I can charge and attack.
Oh my god, can the bear, the bear?
Yeah, let's just all come in and just Hulk smash his leg.
Okay. Right. Everyone charges.
Bam.
Let's have your initiative. That's your initiative, 22. Okay. Jimmy gets 22. Everyone else? I suppose Cubby gets 22 as well. Okay, 12 for Yigbeth. And Keys gets an 18. Nice. Okay. So the Etin gets a... Oh, goodness. He literally gets a 0. Okay. How do you roll 0 on a 20-sided dice? That's how. So, let's see. Okay, so Cubby and Jammy are the first to go. Now, before we do that, we have to resolve this trying to tackle him thing. Okay. So, Keys and Yigbeth and Cubby charge in, no holds barred, and try and rugby tackle this guy to the ground. Am I right?
I'm totally doing a slide tackle. Yes, I'm breaking ankles, but I'm not trying to do like permanent damage. Like again, like I'm not. What I'm trying to do is just kind of give him a real Kobe, shock.
Kobe is running
and make it so that he stands. He's kind of moved off his center of gravity and unable Kobe to attack Jami while this process is going on.
Is running in the way to hit him that is not going to make the Etin fall over and kill Jami.
Right, so he wants to make him fall over forwards.
Yeah, like, we're all trying to. Yeah, we're not trying to smash Jami underneath the great weight of this thing. We're all coming at it from like appropriate lumberjack angles.
Yes.
Okay, so essentially to do that, it's a strength rule in all cases, unless you've got something very specific else in mind.
We all come together and.
Form like Voltron?
Do one roll, yes.
I think it'd be funnier if everyone rolls.
I have a feat that says after dashing you can use a bonus action to attack or push a target 10 feet away.
Okay, this target is too big.
Okay.
He is extremely, like, yeah, this is a huge creature. But maybe if you roll a 20, and I certainly
go bear go.
Strength,
so bear strength. Rolls well. Yeah, strength. Holy crap! Right, okay, that's very good. And let's see, Blaze Keys still has to give a mighty charge.
One sec. I'm looking up there. There is a thing for shoving. Is this are you using the rules for shove?
Not really. But if you have a rule there, go for it.
Yeah, this says using the attack action, you can make a special melee attack to shove a creature either to knock it prone or to push it away from you. If you're able to make attacks with multiple attacks, if you're level 5, which you're not, this attack replaces one of them. The target of your shove must be no more than one size larger than you. So this thing is large and we're medium. It has to be within your reach. So yeah. You make... Okay. So this is going to be juicy. We're not going to move this dude at all. You make a strength athletics check contested by the target's athletics or acrobatics.
Okay.
The target chooses the ability to use. It's probably going to be athletics for that guy. If you win the contest, you either knock the target prone or push it 5 feet away from you, and we're all trying to knock it prone. Okay. So we're all going to make a contested, like that thing's going to make a single athletics check, and we're all going to roll against that.
Cool.
Our athletics.
Yeah, Yggdrasil has already done very well in that regard.
Yeah, let's stick with Yggdrasil's roll for that, sure.
Yeah. But, you know, still roll it, just in case. Not so good. Okay. Etten makes his roll. That is a 21. So, yeah, yes. You do beat him. Wait, that's 21. Right, okay. So the Etten does, in fact, fall over. And since it was Yggdrasil doing it, what direction did she come in from?
And then breathe. Yeah. That was the end for the final push.
Yeah.
I like
Where's your mini? Is it in there?
Yeah.
Or am I just... Oh, of course, right. I'm not seeing it. Okay, so...
I like how Stason is just in the house.
So the Etten goes staggering this way after Yggdrasil's mighty push. You hold on. He puts a foot down on a log that's right there and essentially just goes tumbling over on his face on this side. So for now, he is... he is like that, and he's not very happy.
Yes, then I'm gonna get him. I'm gonna put a rag on his face.
Okay. So, what do you want to do now? Essentially, you got a free go because you stealthed up on him, but now it's your in turn order.
Oops.
So what's happening with this?
The Etten has essentially fallen over now. He's face first on the ground. Jammy has not a very tight grip on him, but...
Yeah, I'm going to go put the rag on his face again.
Okay. Right, give me a little roll.
This is going to be a big roll. How dare you, sir?
That is a big roll. Yeah, you get a good clamp over it, and you feel that head of his just take a big sucking breath in. And, yeah, plenty of ethers going in there. However, he's still rumbling. He's still going for it.
And give him a little slap.
As a free action.
It's your go.
Okay, Cubby, not going to go?
Oh, Cubby, sorry. Sorry, Cubby.
Cubby, also.
Him on the head.
Apologize to Cubby right now. Thank you.
He's going to run up and headbutt him. Boom.
Good bear. Okay. Right. I'll say for the sake of argument that, you know, doing a certain amount of damage to him is not going to, it's not going to permanently harm him.
Same to attack him.
It'll make him weaker. Okay. So Cubby.
I can attack him.
You can attack him.
Okay. That looks like a 19 on my screen, just saying.
Yeah, it is a 5, though. Is it? Yes, it is. That really does look
it's
like
it. Dice roller, I don't like it.
It's a cheating.
Constantly rolls on its side.
Yeah.
It's
okay,
like
Cubby
misses and hits Jammy.
You see
no, that
Cubby
was for damage, though. Wasn't
ceiling
it?
Overhead.
No, that's the hit.
No, that's the hit.
Oh, whoops.
Cubby goes skidding around and completely messes up. So, Keys, it's your go.
Okay, I'm picturing kind of when the Lilliputians came together to just swarm on and tie down the Gulliver. So I'm just going to run over and pull a rope out of my pack and begin to try and hogtie this freaking dude. I'm just going to grab one of his limbs and begin tying a rope around it. And then eventually, once I've got that, I'm going to lasso it to another limb on my next turn.
Okay, cool. And give me
how do you want to? Yeah, how do you want to resolve the rope tying attempt?
Let's see. It's more of a dexterity thing, that I would say. Mm. So yeah, give me an attack based on your dex.
Okay. Do you think sleight of hand would work for that? Okay, I'll just throw the dex because I would not be proficient in. Hang on. Okay.
Okay. Wow.
Is it a saving throw? Is that the right thing that you're asking for?
It doesn't matter. Not really, but you did throw, a 17 plus whatever. So that is. That's totally great. You get the rope around the ankle, was it? Or the arm?
His ankle, definitely. Ankle. I'm grabbing his ankle right now, and then I'm going to run over. The plan is to jump over crosswise and grab his other limb next.
Okay. Right, Yubith. It is all you.
So, what did the police do? Tied him up?
Essentially, that's it. It sounds like you're going to tie him up to slow him down, get enough ether into him. That he falls asleep.
I have a thing which makes me utter a single word, and
yes.
Dude has to obey it unless he succeeds. A wisdom check.
Okay. Right. What is the target number on the wisdom?
13.
Okay. Come on, Etten. He rolls a 13. Okay, so I think that does it. So he does not heed your command.
It's annoying. Why isn't it charisma? That's a bit weird. It's not charisma.
Yeah, these guys have 10 wisdom, which is slightly more than I would have thought. So it's the Etten's turn now. And he is lying on the ground, face down, so he's going to be at a disadvantage for this attack that he's going to make, but he gets to make two of them. And, let's see. So, first of all, he's going to try and just throw Jammy off. This is essentially just shrugging you off with a big sort of shrake of his shoulders, and then he'll hit Keys with the other attack. Okay, so, what's he going to roll? Right, he rolls 17 versus your armor class. Jammy?
Hits.
Hits, okay. So essentially he does no damage, but he does throw you off him. And you go back a couple of, 10 feet or so.
This is not 10 feet. if I was on him,
I'd say you're back on another square, essentially. Yeah.
Cool. Where did he move?
Did he move? Oh, I moved him. Dope. Right. Was that it? That was it.
Yeah.
And if it wasn't it, I don't care. I'd say that's it. So he has this big club in his other hand, and he goes for you, Keys, with it. And he rolls a 10 versus your armor class.
14.
Okay. So, the Etten is he's standing, which allows Keys to make a single attack if he wants to.
Okay, I'm gonna.
This is opportunity.
Actually, when you stand up from prone, you do provoke attacks of opportunity. Or wait, I may be speaking out of turn there. I know that it costs you half your movement, but I don't know for sure if it provokes attacks of opportunity. But
can Kobe get him?
If he was right next to him, yeah. And I think he would have been, yeah. So
yeah.
It gets a little fuzzy with the larger creatures.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll go ahead and do... I do get to invoke sneak attack damage if I'm able to hit with this. Just okay. Because you have to have an ally 1 foot or whatever.
So Cubby hits... and how much damage does he do? Oh, wow.
He does... 1d6 plus 2 slashing.
Right. I'm just gonna roll this. It's a rule.
5 hull damage.
Okay, 5. So he gives him a big bat with the paw. And... Okay.
Okay, so here's the point where things get real insane, because I just critted. And when you crit, you roll double damage. But more importantly, there's a specific thing that allows you...
Oh my god, no, stop, you're gonna kill him.
Just instantly kills him.
You can do two... It doubles your sneak attack dice as well.
Jesus Christ. What?
So I just did 11, 20, 26...
No!
On this full... non-lethal damage. You can do non-lethal damage with any weapon in the game.
You just non-lethally stab him with your rapier.
I just non-lethally screwed this guy's day all the way up.
How much? How much was that again? 20.
That was 26.
26. Wow. Okay.
You like swipe his head off and like it's fine, guys. It's non-lethal.
non-lethally bloodied.
Yeah, like especially with a rapier, I basically did just trepan him, like non-lethally, of course.
Damn. Turned him into a fountain.
Okay. He doesn't look like he likes it, but he's okay. As the Etten, as his go ends, you hear a rustling from the bushes. And you see...
And you see... Bree!
Down below.
Where is Bree? We're not seeing anything with her.
You see a certain amount of... armed fellows coming towards you.
Are they the dudes?
They are the dudes.
What? And, where are they?
Sorry?
Not there.
They look like they've essentially... They're not happy at all about you guys trying to take their quarry.
It's fine. Bree is here to sweet talk them.
Okay. And I'm going to say they go next round since they're coming late to the party. So, Cubby is up now.
Okay. He's gonna smack him.
Okay.
Are we at the point? Is that 26 damage not enough to get him to the point of...
Nope. this is a very tough creature.
But this is...
Ooh. So you are, again, running forward and shoving the rag in the face.
Hmm?
Is that right?
Oh, no, it's Cubby.
Oh, Cubby, right, okay. In that case, he bats him with a paw and does... How much?
Let's see. He's going to do 5 damage. Piercing damage this time.
Okay.
Wow.
Okay. So, the Etten takes it like a champ. Doesn't seem too concerned. And, yeah, it's your go. Again.
I just a rag as like a minor action. If it's, I don't know, really not.
No, it's too complicated to get up to his grill.
Can I coat my arrow in ether?
I think it has to be breathed. Correct me if I'm wrong about ether. I rarely
use it. glad to hear that.
No, it's liquid ether.
Yeah, it is liquid ether, yes, but the idea is that the fumes are the important bit. So again... Johnny, need you to climb up on our boy here and just keep up the struggle.
Can I take a little bit of the cloth off and put on an arrow?
That probably won't work. I don't know how that'll work.
Put it in his mouth.
You don't breathe arrows.
No, but you need to free himself off the arrow.
Okay, so what if you just rubbed it on his chest like Vicks?
Vapor rub! Yelp! We're talking. That's it.
I'm guaranteed to hit with this arrow if I
slather him.
Are you sure you want to shoot an arrow towards its head?
Him.
Right in its mouth.
What if you miss?
We're so non-lethally killing this thing.
I'm guaranteed to hit.
You are?
Sure.
Oh, snap. Quinn's about to maybe be able to join. Quinn's typing.
Better be here by the time these guys have to have a go, so she can use her abilities.
Oh, it looks like possibly. Yeah, she's coming now. Wee moment.
Okay, I'll do
radical. Yeah, we're gonna need her in just a second to keep these boys off our tail.
I guarantee.
Okay, so Ja, what are you doing?
Stick an arrow full of ether down its mouth.
No, when you say an arrow full of ether, you're gonna have to explain how it is.
Pull off a bit of rag.
Do you have a water balloon?
Ether it up, wrap it around, and ping it out his face.
Wrap it around the head of the arrow?
The head of the arrow.
Okay. Right, okay. Go for it. Roll your attack. 7. That misses. The arrow goes flying past him, and so does your rag.
Indeed.
Was that the whole rag that you put onto the arrow?
It was a piece of rag.
Okay.
Of course it was.
Keys! Time for some action.
Is there a way that I can... Let me see. I've got enough... where are... Stay still, Jami. Come on. I need to figure out where you are. Okay, I've got more than enough movement to go to Jami and like try and grab the ether and then climb up this guy myself.
Okay,
we're about to switch roles, you and I, Jami. You're in charge.
You can have some of it. We can share.
That's real sweet. Thank you. Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you. Wow. We just really solved the problem there.
Okay, I have it. I should have coded.
Friends roofie together.
Yeah, that was a really that was a character building moment. Thank you.
I should code Kobe and Ether. we just take a step back. And, you know, it's only a matter of time before both Cubby and the Etna knocked out.
Now, there is a plan.
Right, actually.
Oh my god, I should have had like a Trojan bear situation.
Oh man!
The bear, Cubby just.
Oh, it's like just a big old cotton ball shoved into his grill.
Wanders in.
Oh, and have the bear roll up like Sonic the Hedgehog all up into his grill piece.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, well, we missed out on that one. I'm going to go ahead and try and climb up this bad boy and roofie the same head that Jami tried to roofie. How do you want me to approach this?
Yeah, you're going to have to give me some sort of athletics roll in the same way.
But
okay. That actually does it because it beats his AC.
Nice.
Or doesn't beat it. It matches it.
Okay.
So yeah.
All right. So I've got my left arm wrapped around him. I've dropped my rapier to the ground after having used it to non-lethally murder this guy, and I'm putting the ether back onto his grill piece.
Okay.
With my right hand.
Right. That's grand, and I'll just keep a total of how many ethers he gets. Okay. Done. So, Yggdrasil, you are up.
These are enemies, right?
These are guys approaching you with a mean look in their eye.
They're upset because we're undermining the entire process, but from their perspective, we are guys who are out to poach these Ettins, and steal their work that they feel that they are underpaid for, and that I actually probably talked us into getting paid better than they did, because I talked us into 50% raise. So
I shouted at them, "Please stand back. We are in a very delicate situation here. I do not want you to be harmed."
Oh yeah, you're gonna be in a more delicate position. Guts hanging out. Oh, are you gone? Who's gone?
I'm,
you can see a couple of them readying like crossbows, and yeah.
Quinn. Oh, thank God.
Quinn, I needed a sweet talk. I needed a sweet
talk. Oh, man, we needed you exactly now. Thank you.
Quinn returns after a supposedly 1 hour train journey took 3 hours.
Welcome home. Really? Welcome home, Bree Hearthlight. Never been so glad to see my favorite baker.
Oh, wow.
Sleep them or something.
We are not in a good position, are we?
It's not bad.
We're doing great. There's just a surprise that we need you to handle.
I'm great with surprises.
I had a plan. Plan's going brilliantly. But I'll leave Kian for the recap. I'm going to take a bog break. Right back.
We should have coated the bear in ether.
We coated the bear in ether. The bear wandered in, knocked out the Etten. That's not what happened. That's what I wish happened. Instead, I just snuck up on it. It didn't completely knock it out. It's slightly knocked out. Now we have to do
coated the bear in what?
Ether.
That was a plan that came later and, you know, sadly didn't get implemented.
I'm sad, yeah. But
surely the bear would just fall unconscious before it would reach the end.
No, it would take a few seconds, but...
Could we, like, make it wear, like, a mask?
A little mask, bear gas mask.
Okay, so what is the immediate situation?
So
I need you to...
You guys, you have essentially came across this Etten. They, before they did, they actually heard this other party of hunters, if you remember who they were. The guys who normally get the Ettens for Demon. They've essentially now ambushed you guys as you have attacked this Etten.
Okay. So we're attacking the Etten now?
Currently, yes. They have just showed up and haven't had to... They haven't moved yet, essentially.
Okay. So,
can I have a initiative roll from you, Bree?
Yes.
Can she not just go after the Etten, but before the new guys?
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah, if you want, I'll just start you after Yggbeth.
Okay.
Yeah, that was
if that's all right.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Right. That's all good, and let's see. Yeah. Okay, so we'll wait for... No, wait, I don't suppose we really need to wait for Keys to come back. Yggbeth, did you go?
No.
No, okay.
Are these the crossbow guys?
Those guys are the crossbow guys, yeah.
Okay, see, the ones with crossbows, it's those.
I'm going to go here and attack, because
what?
I'm a charger.
No!
What?
Why? We could talk to them. This is my plan for Bree, and she has some ability, probably.
They drew their crossbows.
I mean, they haven't attacked us yet.
They certainly looked like they were going to.
Oh,
okay, before I do that,
your little dice.
Before I ask, well, are you going to attack us?
Yes, okay, I move to attack.
One of them looks puzzled for a moment and looks at the crossbow that they've just loaded. and had aimed at you.
Fine.
Also, he threatened you with, violence earlier. He said your guts are going to be on the outside. So, yeah, they're not looking
too... We can still salvage this, non-violently.
I don't really want to be the
They're not criminals.
Right. Yeah. That's fair.
What do you say to them? If you want to, do you have a plan for the non-violent, or do we just want to go loud?
What can I do with the Etten? What's the situation on the Etten now?
So the Etten is certainly wounded and certainly feeling the effects of the thingamy, the ether, but still going.
Could try and command it again.
Okay.
Or
so. Up to you.
What do I have? Do I have anything? Can I do insight to see what is the motive of our friends?
Your new buddies?
Yeah.
Yeah, no reason why not. Insight 10. What would you learn from that? Not a whole lot, but you would know that Ettins are these guys' livelihoods, and they're certainly not looking like they're in any mood to share.
I think I will just move over here. I am next to him, and strenuously just like look at him. I'm not gonna even use my bonus action.
Well, if you're charging, I'll certainly allow you to make a basic attack.
Yeah, and, I do. Yeah, but I choose not to.
Oh, right. Okay, you're literally just. Give me an intimidation roll.
Okay.
Because that's actually quite good. Intimidation 12. Right. Hold on a second. I'll tell you what, I'll just make a rule of my own. If I beat it, which I didn't, he runs away.
He just runs
away. Yes!
He rolled terribly.
Jesus, that's probably better than an attack.
Probably.
I practically just insta-killed him.
He was so weirded out by what you just did. His brain just short-circuited. So, okay, now it's Breeze go.
Alright. So, I take it that we're past the sort of diplomatic possibility here.
Well, Yigbeth was very diplomatic just then, but
I have a feeling that probably what the diplomacy that worked on one person may have caused the rest to be unreceptive.
They're not looking happy.
I don't know. The ones on the right, these ones.
Yeah.
They've got spears?
Not necessarily. Let me just check. No, they don't. They have long swords.
Oh, okay. So only this one has any ranged capabilities?
Yes, pretty much. Well, actually, you know what? These guys, you do see that they have crossbows on them, but they look like they're ready to, you know, wade in with a sword.
Okay.
You do recognize this guy as the one who sort of spoke up against Enderman as well. This is Selwyn and his mate Victor.
Okay, speaking up against Enderman, as in?
Well, she was essentially just very displeased with the fact that they weren't bringing her Ettins. And you know from what you overheard them saying in the forest earlier, that they have been taking Ettins that they do catch to the, whatchamacallit, the Portly Goblin, to essentially sell them for a better price.
Okay. I feel like I may be missing something here.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point, did our plan change from lead the glorious revolution?
No, I think that's still a possibility. It's on the table.
Blaze wanted me to teach the Ennin how to become a paladin.
Yeah, Blaze, you're going to have to explain your plan again.
Okay, I'm going to relish this. All right, good, because you figure in quite heavily.
Oh, good.
So here's the deal. I actually took the last level in Bard specifically for this plan, took every single advantage that Bard gave me, and I'm going to be using it for this. So I acquired the skill religion. What we're going to do here is Kian and I are going to be ethering this monster so that it's docile. We're gonna get this crowd out of the picture. I don't know exactly how we're gonna resolve that situation, but the deal is we're gonna have this thing docile, and you and I are going to be telling it the stories and legends, and like I'm going to be invoking the dark rites of Orcus, the god of trolls, orcs, ogres, goblins, and so on, Ettins included. And I'm going to be like calling in like the name of Orcus by all his facets, and like just like getting all like black magic and grody with it. I need you to tell this same head stories and legends, everything that you know about this god.
So we're going to sing him the song of his people.
Exactly. Thank you. Perfect. And allow me to sing for you. And then on the other side, Yigbith is going to be counseling and telling the other head everything she knows about how to be a paladin, and completely like invoke kind of like teach it like the invocations that she knows and all that.
I'm going to use my disguise. Turn it into a paladin of Orcus.
Exactly. We're going to have it like lead a revolution for its people. I'm going to try and get it to travel like 40 days and 40 nights away from the city create a society of Ettins somewhere else.
I could have just talked to it like once, said one word, and it just would have been like, oh, completely gone, corrupted. Because
you can't. God,
Jammy's being corrupted.
Corrupted by what?
I don't know, by the city life. Everything he's seen.
It's what your granny elf would have warned you about.
Wow. So anyway, the granny elf was killed. How dare you, sir? Did you know
my backstory? Oh, sorry. I'm very
painful
sorry
backstory. That. Yeah, painful backstory. Wow. You're so sensitive.
Angst.
Yeah, universal. That was really insensitive.
Triggered.
That's it. I resign.
All right. So, but anyway, the plan is to get this thing to like lead a revolution of all the Ettins after hours. We're just gonna let, and then we're as the explosions are racking that entire facility caused by the glorious revolution of the Ettins. By the way, once we drop it off, you and I have 7 uses of Bardic Inspiration between us.
Yeah,
we're gonna give Bardic Inspiration to every one of the Ettins in the stables before we leave. And then they're all going to be like super like blessed and ready for like their next actions or whatever.
Just give the most rousing speech that we've ever given.
And they're going.
How are you going to do this? Like, you're just going to talk like
We're just going to like quietly. I'm just going to like quietly like whisper. Tell them the word. tell them the good word of Orcus and like. Just we're gonna make it natty for him, and then we're gonna let him like superpower charge all these guys, and then after that, here's the deal: if they escape, if they are able to like win the struggle, that's the law of nature, baby. That's nature. So that's for Jami. Like we're working it out for Jami's little nature ethics. He's gotta have, because we're making this Ettin the king of the jungle, baby.
All right. Sounds good.
I mean, I wouldn't exactly call this nature, since we literally drugged an Ettin and brainwashed it.
Yeah, it's lit. It's lit. I can't wait. So anyway, that's the plan.
All right.
Okay. It's ambitious. I like it. Let's go.
Okay, if we are going to be doing this the hard way with these this adventurer group.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like probably a shatter would be in order.
Okay, shatter. Remind.
10-foot sphere. Where's my
10 feet around you?
No.
In an area.
10-foot sphere, 60-foot range, so around a point. Except my phone is charging. One sec. I need to bring up a PDF.
Is it in the player's handbook?
It is in the player's handbook. It is Shatter. It's a spell. Level 2.
Shatter. Oh, and I was looking in the DM's guide because I don't brain good.
Each character must make a constitution saving throw. A creature takes 3d8 thunder damage on a failed save or half as much damage on a successful one. Shatter screws people up, dog. A sudden loud ringing noise, painfully intense, erupts from a point of your choice within range. Is the text.
Yep. Neat. Unfortunately, we haven't really come across any sort of inanimate object-made creatures, because that's what Shatter's really good against.
One day.
Whoops.
Ooh. Oh, that was accidental rule.
There is.
I slipped.
Right. Shatter does not appear to be in.
I couldn't find it.
At least not in the, it's not coming up in the search function.
I mean, I'm reading from the player's handbook right now, so.
Yeah, so am I.
What page is it on?
275 in my copy.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes. So I think I'm going to cast it right between them, so it hits both of them.
Oh, I see. You were talking about the creature as an inorganic material, such as stone, crystal, or metal, has disadvantage on the saving throw, which is crucial. Like, that's cold.
Mm-hmm. Because essentially, if it's made out of, like, crystal, then harmonic frequencies, they mess you up.
Okay. Let's see. So, what is the saving throw that they have?
It is...
Constitution.
Constitution versus DC 14.
Okay. Right, and where are you throwing it?
I am throwing it right there.
Okay, between Selwyn and Victor. Okay, so 14, let's go. Selwyn makes it. Victor doesn't. He rolls a 9. So Victor takes...
So that's 3d8.
3d8.
And half of that for Selwyn.
Cool. Give us their 3d8.
Yeah.
Okay, 12, and then 6 for Selwyn.
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. Okay, good spelling. Okay, so you taught them how to spell. Okay, so he's run away. Okay, crossbow guy 2 essentially just takes one look at his fleeing friend, rolls his eyes, and takes aim at Yigbeth. And he says, I'm made of sterner stuff than that, paladin. And he rolls a... Let's just move on. He rolls a 4. So it's now the Ettins go. Where did everyone else go? Oh, I haven't put them in. Crap. One day, we'll learn to GM.
But today is not that day.
No. Definitely not. Okay, so... Okay, so Selwyn's go now. He takes one look at the architect of his discomfort. 1, 2, 23. Okay. He's just going to move there. He's going to whip out the crossbow and take a shot at you with it.
Yay! So,
it's a heavy crossbow. And he rolls 10 versus your arm class.
Which okay.
I'm guessing won't do it.
Am I a medium creature?
You
I thought are, I was.
I think so, yeah. I think.
No, I'm small.
Oh, is it small? Okay.
Well, does that give a disadvantage?
Maybe it would, but he missed sure with the first rule anyway. So.
No, it doesn't. Not in 5th edition.
No.
It specifically notes that 5th edition is different, like in the handbook about it.
Okay.
All right. Victor, on the other hand, he is charging. 20. I think that's 30. He is going for the Etten. Along with these other guys. Whereas these two are flanking Yigbeth. And they both come in at you with their... what do they have? Short swords. Okay. So you're taking essentially two attacks from them. First one is... short sword... 13 versus your armor class?
Check. It's pretty sure I'm 16. Yeah, 16.
Okay, and the second one is... 15 versus your armor class. Okay. So they're rubbish. So, have I moved everyone? I think so. Except for Victor, who is taking a crossbow... And he is shooting Jammy with it. Don't you just love him?
Okay, and
Victor is the one sort of in the middle here. With the heavy crossbow, he did a 20 versus your armor class. Not a natural.
It hits, yeah.
Hits. Okay. So that is how much damage? That is 8 damage. You have rested, haven't you? Oh, you would have. Should be.
Yeah, we just woke up and traveled here.
Yeah. The Etten... Are you on the Etten, sorry?
Yes, I am on the Etten, currently with the rag on its face.
Okay. So the Etten is basically stumbling backwards... I guess you're going with it a bit. And it's flailing essentially at you and Cubby. So with its clubs, it is rolling. Cubby takes, that's like 25 versus his armor class.
Wow.
What is his armor class, actually?
It's not 25, fam.
Yeah. And against you, that's 15.
My armor class is 14, so yes.
Hit. Right. So essentially just... I guess since you're on him, you'll take slightly less damage.
Kobe's on him too.
Yeah. Okay, you'll both take really. Slightly less damage.
He because wasn't really.
Yeah, ruler cool, I'm going for it. So, let's see. What do you take? You take... Okay, you take keys. You take 6 damage, and Cubby takes 5.
Cool.
Okay, I got bonked in the head, but I'm still trying to clutch the rag to this guy's mouth.
The one head that's not being sort of suppressed is like screaming at you, just bloody murder. He's like, "Stupid Yumi, stupid Fuzzy," and yeah.
Oh, he's fuzzy.
He's quite articulate. So, Cubbies, go.
Cubbies just kind of smack him, I guess. Yes. Okay. And...
14, yeah. That hits.
It's going to be 5 damage.
5 damage, okay. Come on, Itten. Okay. Looking reasonably hurt.
Can he back up without taking an attack opportunity?
So he's gonna like jump off him. I'd say so. Yeah.
Okay, he's gonna go. What's that? 20 feet. Yeah, just got to here.
Okay. Basically, just hanging back to lick his wounds.
Yes.
And it will be Jammy's go. Yeah, we need to get that bear more health.
Give him some more.
Yeah, I have like.
Get that bear some health, stat!
I have like. Almost 3 times.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Can we like buy armor for Cubby? Bear armor.
That'll be $4.99, please.
Yeah.
Okay, so you rolled a 13 versus armor class, which actually hits.
Yes.
But if you put clothes on him, then he won't be bare.
No.
One D 8 plus 3.
How much damage does you do? 8. Okay.
He's also got a back up by here, back up over here.
Okay.
Lick each other's wounds.
Well, calm down there. Calm down there. Lay on hands.
Keys is
okay. So I'm still riding on the back of this goober. He just kind of clobbered me a little with his club, but.
Yeah,
I'm still grasping him. I still got the ether up to his mouth, and I'm just gonna say like, "Shh."
That doesn't sound sinister at all.
It'll be okay. Shh.
Okay.
Go to sleep. Go to sleep.
Right. They're gonna attack the Eden now. They're gonna try and kill it. We literally only have three protecting the end.
Why don't we just go look for it?
Yeah.
This hasn't even been hard.
Just leave it. But we wasted so much ether on it.
We doused the bear and everything.
We bought ether for more than just an end. Actually, we bought enough for two.
Did we?
Because we have two heads or something. I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, keys, it is still your. You have to make some sort of attack rule too.
Okay. Sure. By the way, the reason why we only have one dose of ether is because Jami cheaped out because I didn't have the money. So I was like, Jami, why don't you pay for the ether? Why don't we get enough for two? And then he was like, no, I'm sure we only need the one for the one head. So here we are.
Did that happen?
Yeah, actually. Maybe you forgot with your 4 campaigns.
I'm not
100% sure. Okay, I'm gonna. I don't actually have like a.
Why wouldn't I have given you money?
I don't know. You were like, I only want to spend 30 gold or whatever. It was 30 gold.
What? Okay, whatever.
Okay. So I have no idea. Like this is an attack with like 0 modifiers based on strength, which I don't think. Actually, that's not actually correct. It should not be based on strength.
Dexterity would work since you're already up in his face.
Okay, so let's roll that instead. There's what I got.
Okay, that misses. So essentially, he's thrashing his head back and forth and keep the rag in place. Okay, right. So
I'm still on his back.
Is he whipping his hair back and forth?
Watch him nay-nay. Can we watch him nay-nay?
I don't know what you people are saying.
Challenge the Et into a dance battle.
And here I was complaining about being old. You don't even know about the nay-nay. Shame.
I don't even. It's shocking, I know. Did you bring the big piece of cardboard? No?
What?
To the gun show?
No, for the dance spell.
Oh, okay.
Right, it's my turn to make references no one understands.
No, that was a B-boy reference. Yeah, like you gotta have a boombox too, though. Like you gotta have like one of the old school tape decks. That's what I'm talking about.
Well, you've got a bard.
B-boy stance. Everybody, break out Adidas tracksuits for everybody. It's gonna bust a move.
So it's Yggdrasil's go. Have you got some dope fly moves?
No. Everything is an action.
That's the spirit.
Everything is an action, and I kind of want to attack and do something else.
Okay.
I can't move because I'll take an attack of opportunity
from everyone.
You can move one square without taking an attack of opportunity.
But what I'll do over here. Can I attack him over here?
You can move that and attack. Yeah, that's no problem. Essentially, one square is like a careful move.
Yeah, sure. I can take this. Where is my weapon? There it is. Attack.
Million dice.
Ooh, right. Okay. So that is 14 damage, that definitely hits, and let's see. He takes a huge amount of damage, but he does not look happy at all.
Is he bleeding?
Badly.
Can I use my bonus action to take a drop of his blood?
Do you have a little tap on you?
Ram a spigot in him.
How do you check my inventory? Then?
Do you have a little vial or something?
Let me check.
If you're wearing gloves, you can just kind of like smush him in there and then wring him out for the drop later.
I have a water skin, I guess.
Oh, hey, there you go.
Okay. Is it empty?
I guess so.
Watered down blood okay for your purposes? Like, if there's water in there, is that cool for your purposes?
Probably not.
I mean, you could just
empty it. Pour it out for your dead homie, Vaporu.
I mean, I also have a backpack. Can I store a drop of blood in my backpack? I have a belt pouch.
As long as you don't mind getting dry. If I'm understanding you correctly, you want just a drop.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I mean, I'll take as much as I can.
Oh, right, yeah. I think there's a discount in bulk.
If you take it all, you don't have to pay them at all because they're dead.
How much?
That's why I don't give blood.
What amount of blood is acceptable to be taken with a bonus action?
With a bonus action?
Yeah.
I may have to look this up in the rules. Put it in the wineskin, in like a water skin or whatever?
Yeah.
Okay. I'd say you only managed to get a couple of drops just in.
Sure.
Essentially, just because it's not the best way to do it. Maybe you could, like, get a palm full of it.
I'll buy something at some point. Like a vial.
Yeah. Some sort of blood extractor. Maybe some
syringe.
Sort of pump.
Just to get a syringe. Like, excuse me, enemy. Please stand still while I take your blood.
So.
We're getting into syringes and dark magic and rituals. Like, what's good? This is adult-oriented material, people.
That's the end of that very strange turn.
The crate and kobold going off the deep end.
They were good guys, and now they're not. It's Bree.
Just like every time I play Skyrim. Stop. Good. I know it. I'm the listener of the Dark of the Dark Brotherhood.
Oh yeah. Right. So right. It is all you.
I think I am going to throw my knife at this guy.
Okay.
Because... What about these guys? We're going to kill our Etin.
Oh, we don't want them to kill our Etin friend, actually. That's true.
They're a ghoul.
Oh, yeah, they want to capture it.
Yeah, they want to trepan it, so... My worry is that trepanning might be instant if they're able to get to it, but they might just be trying to get me off of it.
Trepanning is not going to be instant unless they have some sort of magical artifact to trepan. Like, it requires drilling through the skull.
Oh, yeah, you're not just going to be able to... Well, I mean...
You, if you take a look at one of them, you do notice that they have those little... sinister, horrible-looking punches that Enderman has.
Which one?
It's basically just like a big iron bar with a cross-section that allows them to quickly trepan these things.
Yeah, but which one of them?
You would need a lot of strength to just punch a hole in the skull of an Etin.
They've also got hammers.
Hmm.
So, yeah.
I guess it's still not going to be instant, though.
No.
It's still going to take a while.
Can we see
multiple swings?
Can we see which one of them has the thing?
When that begins, can we see a progress bar?
Yes. You have to hold down the E key. It would be on Selwyn and also Victor. They would both have these equipments.
I think Yigbeth is in more need of help than Blaze and Jarmin and Cubby.
I'll totally be fine. I have full health. I have 38 health, I'll be fine.
Oh, okay. I misheard you there. I thought... Oh, I'll totally be fine. I've got, 4 health. One for each enemy.
One for
each. They hardly do any damage. That's the best thing about them.
Although I think it has been a while since I used my ladle for something other than cooking. So I think I'm gonna go into close combat because I am
serve
if
them up
to Bree. It has not made her less courageous.
Oh, okay.
Bold. It's not made her less bold.
Yeah.
So. I am going to roll. Where is it? Ladle. Finesse. Attack.
Okay, that hits. Any particular place you want to hit him?
I would say head, but I don't think I'm tall enough. I'm going to go for the kneecap.
Right. Big sharks. Ah! Stupid halfling. Up. Hello?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so...
Although, I suppose I could have done the whole sort of Terry Pratchett dwarf thing. The dwarf adage of if your chest's level with their knees, your head's level with their groin.
Yeah. But let's say you've got some sort of armored codpiece.
Who's really rocking an armored codpiece, though? Come on.
Anyone who's anyone rocks an armored codpiece.
That's true. Just ask Zangief.
I mean, I do in real life, but who in D&D does that?
That's true. Okay, so...
I have my Blackadder phallus codpiece.
Whenever I think of codpiece now, I can only think of Hussey's codpiece.
Hussey's?
Andrew Hussey.
Not familiar.
all characters in his webcomics, they have when they have cod, the characters which have cod pieces, let's say that the cod pieces is shaped rather differently to normal cod pieces, and is designed to be rather more impressive.
I'm clearly missing out on something, but I shall educate myself later.
Might take a while.
This guy, who Yggdrith has just maced impressively, he essentially just looks down on himself and thinks, no, this isn't worth it, and runs for it.
Wait, nice. I need your blood.
He
starts running faster.
It's fine, I've kneecapped my one, you can take his blood.
Okay.
You're just becoming more and more horrific for the bad guys.
Selwyn takes a look at you, Bree, and he basically whips out this big battle axe thing that he's... No, wait a second, sorry. I'm looking at the wrong one. Longsword.
Oh, okay.
And swings at you with... Ooh, that's a 23.
23. Yeah, I'm going to say
taking
that's...
Taking that's going to hit.
Probably going to hit.
Okay, so, and he does... Where is my 8-sided dice? Where'd it go? Okay, there it is. He does 6 damage.
Okay.
Victor, on the other hand, he is charging up 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. He is, with the longsword, essentially, he's actually going for the Etin first, because he seems to think that's the larger threat. And he rolls a... what is that? Yeah, that hits. And he is doing some of your work for you. But he only rolls a 3. The other two, by comparison, essentially charge and are trying to mob keys off the Etin. So you're taking 2 attacks. Both with he does terrible. Second one, he does well. That is like a 19 plus something.
14.
Yeah. Okay. So with his sword, he what does he do? Okay. So he does 6 damage.
Okay, I'll yell at the Etin, fall, damn you!
The Etin does not comply yet. These two are going after Yggdrith. They basically move in and start attacking. Same idea, short swords, and first one, that's a 16 versus your armor class.
I have 16, what does that mean?
That's a hit. And the second one, that's a 15 versus your armor class. So one hit, and he does 3 damage. Not terribly impressive. Okay, and it's the Enton's go. So, he's making 2 attacks. He goes for keys, and he actually goes for one of the guys who are attacking you. So, against you, he rolls... A 14 versus your armor class, was that?
14 is my armor class.
It's right. And let's see. And he rolls 5 damage.
Okay, at this point I am battered. I'm like at less than half my health. And I've just been like getting wailed on as I'm just holding on to this damn.
So, with his other attack, he is essentially number 3 guy, and he rolls critical, so that's not good. So, what happens is he brings his club down on the head of this guy, and the head is no more. He just smashes it.
Want to see a magic trick?
Essentially, The Etin starts laughing at this and he says, "Gonna suck your blood out." He's clearly incredibly pleased with himself.
Mm. I mean, I would be.
And we knew that we knew that Yigbeth would be as well by this point. So, yeah. There now, there's a body that you can take and basically turn upside down like a sauce bottle. Cubby, it's your go.
Oh, hey, Yigbeth, you've got an ample source of blood now.
Yeah.
Da, 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 da. Da, da, da. Da, 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 da. Cubby's gonna roll. Okay, Jammy. Boom. Hop on Cubby. And they're gonna... Cubby is gonna sprint at the... Sick
double attack.
He's gonna sprint at the Etten.
Okay.
And go in for a pounce. At the same time, Jammy's gonna jump off and try to, like, can I try and attack him with the jump and just do it like that as a normal attack and stuff? That's flavor text.
The Etten.
Yeah.
After. Yeah, I'll allow it. Like at this point.
So Cubby is he has to save on. It hits with a mod, okay.
Okay.
So I have to beat 12 on this.
12 or over.
On my thing. 4 and 20.
Yes. Okay, that's it.
So he's knocked prone. Does 5 damage.
Oh wow, is that some special attack?
Yeah, pounce.
Cool.
And then, now that he's prone, he can bite him. For... if he hits. Nope, he doesn't hit. So.
Okay.
And then Jammy's gonna hit him. Try to hit him. It's a sword.
Hits.
Hits. And that does. Can I shoot him with my longbow from just like close range? Because there's just more damage.
Yeah, sure. Why not? Although, actually, yeah, you can. But normally that would incur an attack of opportunity. Okay, so that does 11 damage. Right.
And I really impressed these guys.
You're like, dude, that guy has sick abilities.
Mad skills.
Okay, so Jammy is done. Keys, what are you up to?
Let's see. So what's the status? I see that one of these fellows is dead.
Yes, very dead.
What is the status of this gentleman with the decal on him?
That is actually on the Etten. It's fine.
Okay.
He hasn't been hurt yet. But, yeah, he looks a bit shaken, actually, after seeing his friend just get considerably shorter.
So I'm gonna use my left arm, you know, wrap around the Etten's neck. I'm gonna be clutching it and just like trying to choke it out while I'm keeping the ether up, and I'm gonna yell. I'm gonna do my best to intimidate this guy. Like, do you all want to die for no reason?
Intimidation roll.
I'm gonna intimidate him. It's gonna be real rude.
Okay. Wow. Okay. They start to back off. In fact, they start to realize, yeah, this isn't worth it. And I'm going to say that you have just essentially...
Even the dead guy runs away.
Even the dead guy. Like, no. I mean, I can handle my head being smashed in, but no. This is just too much. So, yeah. Everyone starts to say
Ettins I can handle. Smashed it.
He's gonna go drop your money.
Okay. Strangely, some of the money comes out of your wallet and flies into theirs.
No.
That they're not terribly convinced. They just peg it. Anyone who wants to do, if you want to like try and stop them in any way, now would be the time to say. But otherwise, they're gone. And no, the Etin himself is looking rather woozy. You didn't actually make an attack on it, and I'd say with a little bit more, you know, ether, all will be well.
What happened? After Keys scared everyone away?
Keys essentially convinced them rather robustly that, you know, this wasn't going to end up. Yeah. Well, I mean, it's the sort of thing. When they're hunting these things, they want to be in a large pack win with any sort of disadvantage. So this was kind of a desperate move on their part. And now that they've, you know, things have gone so badly for them already, they're out. So it's just the Etin left. And Keys, you still have an attack to make.
Okay.
So dexterity. Things whipping its head back and forth, just like you do. And, oh, that's no problem. It's much able to, you know, it's slowing down. You can see sort of its eyes start to cross. And, yeah, from general blood loss and exhaustion, it stumbles to its knees.
Does he have, like, a skull and crossbones in his eyes?
Yes.
A non-lethal skull and crossbones.
It comes up no seal.
I'm going to headbutt the back of its head.
It's Pokemon's soul spiral.
Yeah, now we're
cycling. Spiralized.
Touch Fuzzy, get dizzy. He tallies dizzy.
Small attack.
Oh, we should have held Cubby up to his mouth.
I mean, coat of, for your family, a coat of arms, and underneath it just says, touch Fuzzy, get dizzy.
For Jammy's so, family.
Anyone whose family who wants it, really. Because
certainly the solo dolls, yeah.
That has
Elmira family.
Well, go to the engraving shop tomorrow. So, right. So the Etin basically slumps to its knees. It stops bellowing its litany of curses and screams and just mad ramblings. And as it sort of lies there, sort of semi-conscious, it starts reaching out to the body of the headless dude beside him. Basically, he grabs an arm and starts to...
Eat up. You'll need your strength.
You will need your strength for the fight ahead.
My sweet. I think we all give him a little rub on the head.
Yeah, like, we're all really supportive. This is a supportive environment for this guy right now. Like, we're gonna lead you to a way of life, my
up,
friend.
I'm gonna clean him up and put him in a suit while running.
Yeah. I will use my... I've got I've got an Etten-sized business suit. No, I don't. But I'm gonna. Yeah, I've got a big enough baker's hat to put on one. I'll go ahead and put that on his head. I am gonna use the disguise kit to mock up a wound on the affected ethered up head, and then I'm gonna say, okay, guys, we gotta get him up on our shoulders and get him walked back.
I'm gonna tie him off to Cubby, and we're gonna help him that way.
Excellent. And as Cubby is hauling, the plan is that me and Bree in one ear, me whispering blasphemies from the darkest pit, and Quinn singing the song of the orc people, and then Yggdrasil will be in the other ear, spinning a stirring speech about dedication to one's god and the great discipline that it lays, but how noble it is, and we're just gonna give this joker the pep talk of a freaking lifetime, and invoke the god Orcus to like bless his freaking foul smelling minion.
I'm just gonna walk ahead and kind of get out where.
So you're making your heady top of the lift, essentially the funicular.
Right. Yes. We're going back to the place where we would turn him into Enderman.
Yeah.
At this point. So I am just hoping we don't get further attacked because there's like blood, you know, just pouring out of my head at this point. But
can I take control of it?
You can. I offer you as much blood as you can carry.
You know, at this point, I'm wondering if Yggdrasil actually needs all this blood for her spells, or if she's actually a vampire.
I like either one of those at this point. Keyes has taken a very dark turn with this like proficiency in religion. So, and not to mention, like, I literally haven't. I have. An unseen servant now as well. Like it's lit, guys. Anyway, the point is we're gonna be pulling them back to the stable. I've already put like a big egregious head wound on with my disguise kit. It comes equipped with makeup and so on.
And you're whispering about this massive bloated demon prince. Bile and contempt. And I'm doing a quick bit of reading on Orcus here.
In its other ear, I'm just softly going, "Wah!"
Yeah, like death metal. Yes.
Suddenly Orcus the Etten goes to space.
Yes. Orcus would love death metal. It's on. This is going to be so. This whole thing is going to be metal as hell, guys.
Okay.
I mean, I am also like reciting stories about great, great battles fought in the name of Orcus. But
okay. And let's see, Yggdrasil, what are you doing?
I'm like taking Blaze's blood and smudging like symbols on the Enden's forehead and like reading. Furiously chanting from my book.
Oh, don't put symbols though. We gotta make it look good. So maybe if you put symbols on, like make it under its clothing, under its like ratty, fetid, like foul smelling, rotting fur.
As he rips off his shirt.
Just so you understand, the Etten is only wearing a loincloth.
Well, yeah, you gotta put arcane sigils on this thing. It is on.
Okay, and what it will entail?
This is how you make a god, people. The god of the unholy ass.
So, what are you trying to sort of impart on it, Yggdrasil?
I don't know, just like religion. I guess I can teach it a few paladin tricks. I'll teach it Searing Smite.
Okay. Any of the healing powers or anything like that?
Nah. I'll teach it Command, so it can do. It can command the other islands.
Yes. And somebody to free them.
Yes!
Okay. What am I going to do now? This is madness. Okay. So, let's see. I'm just going to put you on the map again. Right. So, you essentially... to the where the entrance to the mine is, and the, you know, the lift and so forth. And let's see, where are you on the map? You're here. So Indomin sees you coming, and essentially she sees what to her appears to be a trepanned Etin being dragged along by this successful group.
Did we do the makeup thing?
Yes, yeah, I believe Blaze did that, yeah. Give me a quick roll to see how well you did that.
Sure.
Well, it's Blaze.
Yeah.
Please, so.
Yeah. It's well enough. It won't stand a hugely detailed look, but it's pretty convincing at first glance.
Yeah, and it's a tall thing, so she can't, like, she won't necessarily be right up next to it, you know, like it's like 10 feet tall or whatever.
It's tall and it's also super smelly, so even if she could be right up next to it, she probably wouldn't be.
Yeah. Nah, she's not. She's on record as hating these things, so, you know, she's not going to get it all up in it, in its business. So she comes out and she seems, I mean, she's always been quite grumpy towards you, or towards everyone, apparently. But she seems quite pleased, and she's like, well, I certainly didn't expect results this quickly. You guys, you folks don't mess around.
Nope.
God damn right we
do. We kind of do. Let's kind of. A little bit.
Well, if this is...
Nope, we totally don't mess about, I say, with my fingers crossed behind my back.
Yeah, she elbows me, and I'm like, oh, actually, yeah, you're right, Bree, we don't mess around. Not
well, if these are the results that you get when you do mess around, color me impressed. And she says...
I will hold out my hand for our payment.
Yes, come on into the office, and we'll have the workers here drag this sorry one into the storage facility.
Okay, we will release it to the custody, knowing that the ether, like once the ether wears off, is probably when its paladine powers will activate and all that. So, we've got time. Like there's a long timer on this very very explosive fuse, there's a long fuse rather on this very very explosive bomb. So we're gonna go into the office with Indomin.
Yeah, you can see the caretaker essentially give it a quick once over and say, okay, they look like they're pleased with how it's been trepanned and so forth. It looks like it's in the exact right position, etc., etc. So yeah,
they're totally doctors.
Yes. Well, you were given specific instructions and one of those tools.
Actually, I think I do have skill in medicine. I'm not sure.
Okay. Well, that's all to your credit. Yeah, you're brought into the office. And what was it that we agreed that you were going to get paid?
Like 1,500
each. It was 1,500
each.
Each? That sounds a bit much. Nah. 1,500 for Annette. She essentially opens a safe. You can see that there's quite a bit of money in there. And she takes a small portion of it and hands it over.
I make a mental note of where the safe is and where it will be in the crater that will be.
The crater!
This whole mountain side of the film.
Yes, that is precisely the result I'm hoping for.
Do you think is going to happen here?
Oh, so, you gave him too many paladin powers. He's the final boss.
So what
summon
you...
a meteor.
You know how we defeat immortals.
What is your sort of plan for right now?
Leave.
The plan for right now is... Yeah, the plan for right now is just to take the money. Sorry about that.
Funicular horn. Okay.
There we go. That's our cue to escape. So each of us gets 375 gold out of this because Bop left to go baking. So Eridar's cut goes to us. I nearly offered it to the guys beating up on us until I decided it would be better to snarl at them instead. So I'm keeping this money, guys. Like, I'm all about these funds. I'm the CFO of Brian.
So 375 each.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds right.
Okay. So that's...
So anyway, at this point, we're just going to maybe... Is there a hill in the surrounding area? I'm just looking for a good vantage point to watch what happens. Actually, we're going to have to go to the storage area, you and me. And we're going to... Bree, come with me, and we're going to quickly go around and just say, you know, oh, we need to check out these facilities. Enderman wanted us to look at something real quick.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, Enderman is still in the office with you, and her instinct would be to take you, sort of walk you out to the funicular and, you know, say fare thee well to you.
But, oh, okay. Actually, Indivin, I had a question about kind of the way
toilet.
That these guys...
The toilet.
I've got the toilet.
Is it Indivin, up on I've that got the toilet over there? Which is
no, I don't need to be on the hill right now. No, we've just got to go to the storage area now and give our bardic inspiration to all of these Ettins. That's the last step of the plan, is me and Bree throwing out our 7 bardic inspirations to the entire crew of these subjugated beasts. So I'm just going to say, I wanted to see the conditions that the Ettins were living in real quick. I wanted to, there was a note about the structure of the stable that was really interesting from an architectural point of view, and I'd like to take a look at that.
I would like to sing.
I need to sing.
There's more information coming at me right now. I know what to do. Okay, so essentially, you're asking her to see where the Ettins stay one more time,
right?
Mm-hmm.
And she's
another tour. Like I didn't like it, haha. But we would like another tour, please.
I think we just killed Teddy. Okay. So Enderman's I didn't realize the smell of these things was so enjoyable, but yeah,
it's an acquired taste.
Fill your boots. You want me to show you around again, or
no? That's fine. I actually just wanted to see kind of the structure of this particular portion of the building.
You okay?
Jesus!
Oh God!
I want to sink.
What?
give us that again, Blun.
When Keenan said
what? Have I killed someone again with my jokes?
You have actually done harm.
You should be what? The god, not me. You're the one who can do physical damage with words.
I catch this hideous laugh at him.
Teddy, you're not standing on a roof or near any sort of...
Just give me a minute.
Oh my god.
Just carry on, I'll be...
I can't carry on without knowing what I said.
I want to sing. I was drinking, and... And in a way, it was so funny.
Well, that's just my spells.
That's very true. So, she says, absolutely, if you want to go back to see them, yeah, be my guest.
Okay.
Thank you.
Don't let them all out or anything.
Oh, thanks. You're such a good joker. Thanks for the money.
Anytime.
All right. And we're gonna head into the storage area, and Quinn, you and I, we're going to sing.
I can show you the world.
So you see some of the attendants basically putting this new Etten. They're basically just dragging him into the cell and barring the door.
Oh, the attendants?
Yes.
Attendants.
They essentially, you know...
Universal just completely ignores.
I can't right now. I just... they finish up, and they essentially just... they'll walk past you, and they'll climb up and go out through the office. And they'll
I'm
give
not
you
really
the,
at them.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, with your incredible presence, they were like, yeah, he knows what he's doing. He belongs here. So
and you gotta speak some politically and socially charged poetry.
It's you, beautiful.
You control the means of Ettins. So yeah, what you doing?
All right, I'm gonna go up and whisper. I'm gonna whisper like inspiration and conspiracy and blasphemy and the unholy into the ears of four. I can do four bardic inspirations, and I'm going to give one. I'm going to give one to each of the heads of our paladine, right? Like, I'm going to make sure that this dude has all the superpowers I can do. So I'm going to whisper dread eldritch truths and inspiration into each of the heads of our paladine.
So essentially, you're not activating him now, but you're putting these things in his head to activate when he wakes up. Is that correct?
Exactly. Empowering. Yeah, the way the inspiration works is it does on it like just, your choice of next rolls. So
it gives them a reroll that they can use on any roll, for like a day, I think.
Yeah, something along those lines. I think actually it doesn't give them advantage. It gives them an extra d6 to roll to improve the results of any roll.
Yeah, you can.
So it gives them an extra. It is that they. That they are struck by the inspiration that they need to use it on. So we're just going to empower everybody as much as we possibly can. And I've got four uses of it per day, and I think Bree has
three. I've got three.
Okay. So we're gonna spread it. We're gonna spread this terrible, blasphemous Orcus love among seven of these things.
How do you?
Or rather, six because I have two.
Of bardic inspiration than Bree.
Because my charisma stat is really high because half elves get a huge bonus to just solely to charisma.
Yeah, because it's based on charisma.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So with that done, you're essentially you see a sort of strange looking functioning head of these Ettens. But it's hard to tell, you know, exactly what that means. But definitely something has happened.
Hell yeah. We just set up a time bomb.
mm-hmm.
Let us go to an overlooking hill and watch the carnage unfold. It's a good thing I packed all this popcorn, guys, because we're going to need it.
Who wants to see the file?
How are we going to get down without the funiculars?
Well, the funiculars are still running.
We'll ride Cubby.
Well, they won't be very soon.
I think we should go.
No,
down.
I mean, you would still be able to get up and down, you know.
Yeah, the Ettens that are currently in the... Yeah, well, the thing is, the Ettens in the funiculars would still continue running, like, regardless. Like,
Yeah, it would just mean you'd have to walk through the city streets, you know, it would take longer.
Yeah.
Okay, good. So you would have to leave through Enderman's office.
That's the
oh, that's the fire engine, yeah.
Yeah, that's the fire engine.
Wow, it's already starting.
Yeah.
I thought they were coming to save Teddy.
Yeah, the place is
oh, no,
already
that's
starting.
That's police as well.
Wow, there we go, yes.
And possibly ambulance.
There's just like a news helicopter.
Send everything.
stunned everything. There's a crazy pound and head and thing.
Yeah. My house is directly opposite a fire station and an ambulance station.
Right. They're sending in the Hulkbuster squad.
They'll need it.
They're sending in the policemen with like hoses to stop the rioters.
Right, okay, so you have to leave through Inderman's office. Essentially, all the other doors are pretty much barred.
We all have to say in sequence that the pastor going through her office by...
she walks you out. She essentially, walks you out to the funicular, which she assumes that you're going to, go to.
Now, again, we all say in sequence, bye.
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 I whisper... You're fucked.
Sorry, excuse me?
Nothing.
Bye.
Right. I just want to say thank you again, and please, just anytime you want to, anytime you want to hunt again, just I'll support you in that, and if you make this a regular thing, I will. Indeed, I will pay you better.
Sure, oh yes, we'll most definitely consider that.
Yeah. Yes, it's just the funicular is all important to this city. I don't know what we do without it.
Oh yes, I have no idea.
Absolutely, glad to contribute to the civic infrastructure, madam.
Excellent. Okay, well, I'll let you get on with whatever it is you need to do. And she basically gives you a wave and. Spidsy well.
At least we don't.
Farewell.
At least we don't. Goodbye. We don't give a
fool.
Goodbye. All right. So we're gonna. At this point, we are going to divert ourselves. If she actually escorts us onto the funicular, like I will kind of encourage everybody to just go ahead, and then we'll circle back up to the top if we have to. But we're gonna find out.
Why don't we just let it happen?
Well, I want to watch. I want to know. I want to know what form.
Want to know what love is?
Yeah, this is a plan that I have been in real life thinking about and cracking up about for like 3 weeks now. Okay, like I've been laughing about this for a long time.
That's a love for Universal to live up to.
That's true. That is true.
And since I didn't know what you were planning, yeah.
Oh my god, yes, that's perfect. That's all the better, in my opinion.
Interesting.
I'm up my own hype so hard, dog. Universal, if you want us to head down this funicular, I will go down this funicular for you.
Absolutely up to you which way you want to go.
Okay.
I will say that essentially around the time when you start to... When Inderman leaves you alone... Let's say, are you looking at where the party is right now?
We are, so the next day, and I can read the headline in a newspaper.
If you want
to play it like that. So no, just letting
you know. I definitely want to say what's going to happen now.
Okay.
So, what happens is. You're going up somewhere higher on the mountain, right? Is that correct?
That was
So I'm going to say you go off onto a little outcropping up here.
So I was trying to figure out who was pinging there, and I realized Universal, Quinn, and Blaze all have like slightly different shades.
All purple. Tell you what,
purple's my favorite color, man.
Purple is objectively the best color.
True.
I'm just going to have to settle for less. So you're on a little sort of rocky outcropping here, and you're essentially watching down on the storage facility, waiting for things to pop off, as they say in the hood. So,
yes,
the first thing that comes to your attention is bells start to ring down in the city.
Mm-hmm.
A number of them.
The first Etten marriage.
Jesus. We all wake up from a really weird dream.
Fast.
morally, can and Etin's heads marry each other?
Well, these are questions we're definitely going to be exploring in season 2.
I mean, they practically argue like a married couple.
Yeah. And so you hear all these you hear all these bells sort of ringing, and you look out to the city to see what's going on, or to get some sort of idea what's going on. And you don't see anything at first, but then you look out over the sea, and you see a large number of ships coming into view. And Yggdrath, you might get a slight sense of deja vu, because you could have sworn something like this was in your dream.
Remind me?
Come, my Etin brothers, as an Etin army from another continent.
So you try and remember your dream, but you can't there quite... Was, you know how it is with dreams.
I remember a lake, was black, and people got impaled, and then I was about to get impaled. I don't remember any ships.
There were definitely ships.
Okay.
It was... Wasn't that dream, like, essentially the start of Dark Souls 2? Like the sort of big black lake, loads of things flying around, everyone falls in.
You know what? I didn't even think of that at the time, but yeah, I totally ripped that off, didn't I? But yeah, I mean, that's the sort of thing that was. You see a bunch of what look like very boxily constructed ships heading towards the city.
It's the Fire Nation attacking.
It's the orcs.
They look very grand, very bright.
Oh, okay, it's not the orcs.
And you start, Keys, you start to see some very familiar-looking colours.
The Durans. The entourage from my home.
I saw the balance shifts.
From my home, my sworn enemies are arriving in a grand procession. Perhaps to enable the Arkan to begin a conquest. This is terrifying. It's a good thing these Etins are going to do unholy war against them.
As a Durin, and I think we talked about this before, aligned with the Arkan.
When we eavesdropped on the Arkan, they were talking about a deal that they were doing with the Durans. So these conniving political dwarves, this rival political family that crushed my own.
They did not use the word deal, I should just say. Oh. But that's all I'll say.
Are they political
They talked about a situation.
Are they political dwarves as in they are not very sort of powerful politically, or are they political dwarves?
They are exceedingly powerful politically. They were like a rival political family to my own. Like they're also lords of the city Silver Run that I came from.
Checking: are they literally dwarves?
Yes.
Or was that
a
metaphor?
No, they're a dwarven family, and in fact, Keys is a little bit. Never really has like a fondness for dwarves as a result. He's a little dwarf racist.
Dwarfist.
He's got dwarfism. Wait, no.
I do not believe so, Kian.
So the fleet gets closer and closer as you wait. Now, do you want to go down and see the fleet arrive, or do you want to stay here where you are? Essentially, one thing you can tell is it looks too small to be an invasion, but it's still very imposing.
So it's probably hey, look at us. You don't want to mess with us.
My sense is that if I realize that the Durans are arriving, my sense is that I do not want to look at them face to face immediately, because it could be that those are members of the clan that would recognize me. So my instinct is to stay up here, and just to let everybody know, like, we're gonna have to follow that news very closely and get a secondhand account to be sure. But I do not, like, personally, I would be wary of encountering them. I do not necessarily want them to know I'm in the city, just because I'm still, like, some of them knew about my family and some of them, you know, weren't necessarily party to the intrigue. But I would be very worried that that perhaps they would be after me as well as, you know, my whole family. So
let's watch the fireworks. Let's
yeah.
So okay. What can we see? What can we see? What can like I see from about the ships from here?
What do your elf eyes see?
I shall say, just for the sake of time, you're waiting long enough for the ships essentially to dock, and you can start to see a procession coming off the ship. Before anything else happens closer to you, you do see that, Keys, you see, again, you can make out very familiar colours being flown, that the Durin clan is essentially the main flag being flown, but underneath it, you recognise the colours of the Stirlington family.
Oh, you motherfuckers.
Bum, that's bum, my, bum.
That's my dad's fam. That's my dad's family. What the hell is going on here?
Why isn't Jammy's family in this campaign? Dear.
Because they're hippies.
Fuck you. Said just like that.
Dead hippies.
That's the second season, Ghost Hippies.
And that's the point at which things start to happen closer to home. You hear screams from, they're so loud you can hear them even from the relatively safe remove that you're at. things start to happen in the warehouse. There's a huge roaring noise. Just chaos seems to be happening in there. Enderman runs out of the office and this huge Etten, in fact the one that you brought in, shoulders through the doorway just raking it off.
Bruh, we will not be held down by oppression.
The paladin.
Yes. Paladin, yes. He catches Enderman by a leg, and she is dragged backwards, screaming, her fingernails just raking into the ground, and he essentially starts eating her alive.
Death to the bourgeoisie!
And as he essentially eats her alive, he also pulls her apart at the same time.
Pulls apart her whole like political theory.
Heroes of the city, they will call us.
You hear these crashing sounds, and the funicular starts to shake. It seems like some sort of mechanism is being smashed inside it. It's currently being loaded up with ore. And suddenly something snaps and the funicular just starts to shoot down the side of the mountain. It's like the brakes have been cut.
And once it reaches the end, it blows up all of the ships that are just docked.
It builds up speed and builds up speed with its full load of ore. And essentially halfway down the mountain, it jumps the tracks and shit goes flying everywhere. Houses are being bombarded.
Oh my god.
We're literally destroying the entire
city. Fires start.
Natural.
Essentially, the poor quarter of the city is being absolutely shelled by this cargo.
Should we just stay out
we
of the city?
We just firebombed the city. Oh my god, we just firebombed the city.
God damn it, ladies. First the elves and now this.
This is the second time this week, people.
Considering the Arcan are gonna want are evil, and if they
no one will, no one will ever know that we did this though, because the Ettens have killed everybody who saw us.
Can we market this? Can we? Can
don't
we
the Arcan
give flyers out saying that this is the Arcan?
They haven't killed everyone.
But like the Arcan could have like spies or something.
They have.
Nah, we'll be fine.
They have, for example, not killed the hunters that ran away from you in the forest.
Mm. they would totally. I don't know.
They wouldn't know. They wouldn't know that. We would just say that we brought in our Etin and whatever it was popped off. Like yeah. They don't know that we did anything illicit. So like there's
the
not.
Very, at we the are very worst. Here, people.
I've considered all the
worst,
angles.
They could probably at the very worst they could probably
kill us.
Accuse us of.
Happen? They already don't like
us. They could probably accuse us of like. Hey, you didn't trepan this Etin in the right place. It didn't work.
This is where
they would accuse us of aiding and abetting.
Jammy takes out a piece of paper and a raven comes to him, and he whistles to it, and the raven takes a little scroll, which goes to Jammy's publisher, who releases all of the flyers that blame the Arkan on this.
We should totally stay out of the city for now.
Wait up. We gotta play the Arkan. We cannot openly be enemies against the Arkan. Like they cannot know that we are supporting
like
them.
Already.
But it's so dangerous.
We've got an advantage right now. Look, we've got the advantage of knowing their situation. They have no idea that we're a threat at all.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Because if they do then like we're like literally inside their city and they could
trap us. I know, but thus far, we are completely bulletproof. There is absolutely no suspicion that has rested upon us. We completely successfully escaped from that meeting.
As he says,
that was the clincher.
As he says, that was the clincher. Bulletproof above our lands in front of him.
We could.
Yes.
We could.
Perfect.
Like they said, they
successfully stealth away. No, nobody saw anything except for those hunters. That's literally it. Those hunters could not have anything on us.
Let's just sit back and enjoy
We can just lie to the Arkan. Let's sit back and enjoy the show, and watch the Palatin murder my ancient blood rivals, the Durins. Might even be able to spin this against the Durins. Yes.
So,
all right.
With that, and with the with the destruction of the funicular, several homes and livelihoods of poor people, I think that's a good place to end.
Yep. Is that the end of...
That is the end of season one.
Oh, wow.
You can hear the Etin in the background. I have a dream. Have one day.
Jesus.
Every the valley dream. Shall be exalted.
The Etin's dream appears to be more along the lines of eating people is my dream.
Nah.
I think this has gone absolutely perfect. I don't...
I've got to say, very enjoyable.
I think Blaze is actually just playing secretly chaotic evil characters.
Secretly?
Character sheets.
Please, this is more chaotic neutral, I think.
Yeah,
absolutely, absolutely. Well, here's the thing. I really do consider it like straight up law of the jungle. Like, are those things strong enough to like get out of there? All right, let's do it. It was just I made it specifically for Jammy. Like that's what I was all about.
So it's all Jammy's fault.
I mean, I don't mind.
That's what we can take.
I sweep my hand toward the shelled, firebombed husk of a quarter and say, Jammy, my gift to you.
My eyes light up.
Happy Manu.
Your eyes light up, and so does the city.
I need to head off now.
My head. This has been okay. Last scene. Okay, a silhouette of everyone looking out at the carnage as Jammy's head like leans to the right into Blaze's arms.
Oh, I ship it.
A little heart icon appears above
Kobe
him.
Kobe puts his head on Jammy's lap. Fade to black.
What a beautiful scene.
You all jump into the air, freeze frame. Credits roll.
Exactly. Fantastic season, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Good game.
Also, give us a level. I feel like that's worth a level.
I think we'll start you with a... Yeah, you're up to level 5.
What? Seriously, yeah, that's 3,000 experience.
Oh, yeah.
We leveled up like two sessions ago.
We did...
we did start a glorious revolution.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's not get ahead of ourselves, but one thing's for definitely, you killed a lot of people today.
Yeah.
Indirectly.
And that's the important thing, isn't it?
Oh my god, guys, do you know what this means? This means so many things. That means +3 proficiency bonus, that means one.
Oh yeah,
more.
It's on. It's lit. Here's the thing, though. The Pixies, Where Is My Mind, starts playing. This is the end of Fight Club. We just did the end of Fight Club.
It says, "You met me at a very strange time in life."
My life. Yes.
Okay, I really do need to go now, though.
All right. Take it easy, everybody.
It has been amazing.
Yes.
A great pleasure. Take care,
hopefully,
all.
Hopefully we can get together for season 2 at some point.
Yes, hopefully sooner rather than later.
Can don't you forget about me, play?
Yeah, there we go.
Oh no, I don't want to miss a thing. Don't want to miss a thing.
those all roll over the very long credit sequence that is actually just like just us repeated over and over and over again. Like that's the credits are just like, yeah. Big ups to Blaze, big ups to Ted, big ups to Quinn, big ups to Quinn.
And then it names everyone who we killed.
That actually is long enough to support like 12 songs. Yeah. That is long enough to support an entire album. All right, take it easy, everybody.
Post credits.
Take it easy.
Bye.
Later.